The following is a presentation of SCTV Sports.
This is William F. Buckley, always in control when hosting his provocative series, Firing Line. But will he be in control tonight as he and his team go up against that man there, Carl Sagan, whose series, Cosmos, was, well, to be quite honest, not as effective as he'd hoped. But can he overcome that ineffectiveness as he leads his team in the battle of the PBS Stars?
Scanning the world over to bring you the hilarious and the tragic SCTV Sports.
Hello again, I'm Howard Cosell.
I'm Dick Cavett, and I must say I'm really feeling quite strange being back here at my alma mater, Yale. I feel somewhat awkward, it being the first time I've been back without the complete works of Shakespeare under my arm.
A very witty quip, Dick, but let's not waste any more time. Simply, the object of today's competition, the two teams will compete to see who wins. Now, Dick, please, try and be more concise.
I would, Howard, but I'm getting some confusing directions from off camera. I was never good at taking directions, I must confess, even when I was on Broadway in Simon Gray's Otherwise Engaged. So if you'll bear with me then, we can switch to boxing or wrestling or some such thing.
Which was previously recorded. Rune, we've got to go quicker. I don't mind verbosity, but he's ruining the pace of the show. The crowd is literally buzzing with excitement as Mr. Rogers, representing Bill Buckley's team, enters the ring. Oh, look out there, Fred! The slender chap's not used to this sort of fare. Tonight, he prepares to face the heavily favored Julia Child, the French chef, if you will. More about that later. But first, let's take a look at both fighters in their respective corners as they prepare for the upcoming bout. There's Child, cool and collected, obviously in shape and ready for this fight. But what about Rogers? Experts have questioned, myself included, his ability to participate in so physical a sport, some going so far as to cast aspersions on his manhood itself, and of course the confident Julia Child. And there's the bell starting round one. But there, he rocked Julia Child with a devastating left, and the French chef is visibly shaken. Not unlike George Steinbrenner after his humiliating defeat to Tommy Lasorda's Dodgers. But more about that later. Rogers is chasing her around the ring. She's running in terror. Coco Van, or no Coco Van, this woman is in trouble. This is really disgusting. This is not the sort of fare we're used to bringing. I certainly hope the young fans of Mr. Rogers' neighborhood aren't staying out to watch this bloody travesty. But wait, a sudden turn of events. Child coming on strong, no longer on the defensive. The two of them trading blows like gladiators in the ancient Roman tradition, fighting to the death. This is a tremendous fight. You can feel the momentum actually swinging toward Child. And what just happened there? He grabbed a puppet. Oh, look at this. He's hitting Child with the lovable King Friday. And the French chef is down and being counted out. This is an unheard of tactic. Child is out cold. Why isn't Rogers being disqualified? Instead, he's being declared the winner. I don't have to explain. You saw it. He beat the woman unconscious with a puppet. All the papers will say that Fred Rogers won. But in my opinion, it's a dark day in Mr. Rogers' neighborhood.
Now resume our coverage of the Battle of the PBS Stars.
This is Beverly Sills, who, and I don't know if she'll remember this, I first met at a fundraiser for the Metropolitan Opera hosted by Betty Comden and Adolph Green. I'll have to ask her about that and why they refused to let me sing that night. There, for those of you who don't know, is her opponent, the well-renowned Joan Sutherland. Like Woody and myself, both ladies share brilliant careers and a beautiful and lasting friendship. Should we roll that tape now or not?
Oh, Bev, come on. I haven't sat this still since the death scene in Rigoloni. Boy, this taking so long?
Because I paint from the realist school of painting, like Norman Rockwell. I see it as it really is in life. All right, all done.
Oh, my hindquarters fell asleep. Oh. It doesn't look like me. You've given me more chins than a Chinese phone book.
I don't know that much about sports, but I do know intense concentration when I see it. There she goes. Very good acceleration, I must say. Well, I'm delightfully surprised. I don't think I could clear 10 feet the way Beverly Sills just did, and that has to make Coach Bill Buckley a very happy man, I would think. Jones looking good, good acceleration and concentration. She's pushing out much too high. Oh, dear. So it's a tough break then for Joan, the event therefore going to Beverly Sills, and I guess it's then back to you, Howard.
Buckley!
Though I must say, I would have approached the jump somewhat differently. Oh.
Buckley's team is currently ahead in the point standings, but a victory here in the prestigious touch football competition could tip the scales in favor of Carl Sagan's team. Before we start the event, let's take a look at both captains up close and personal.
I met Carl Sagan at a party recently, and he said something.
I'm Carl Sagan, and today we'll be taking a look behind the scenes at Cosmos to find out what all the various departments do to deliver the show that you see on the air. First stop, makeup. Let's take a look and see what the wonderful people...
Get the hell out of here!
Obviously, they're very busy in makeup, so now let's move on to Studio B. Here in Studio B is where it all happens. The various people work carrying heavy equipment, delivering all parts and all...
Carl, what are you doing in here? We didn't call for you.
I'm doing a behind-the-scenes look for Cosmos.
All right, just don't get in our way. You could get hurt in here.
Well, as you can see, there is tremendous concern and love from one department to another, each mutually supporting it in this wonderful television environment. As we walk now towards the defamed planet set, we will observe through the information that I give that these are heavy lead balls suspended by high-tension wires, which, when dramatically lit, give the show its look of realism. Although, now, this, for example, the sun, would weigh in excess of 250 pounds, and the whole set would cost somewhere in the neighborhood of...
We know, billions and billions of dollars.
Well, maybe not billions and billions of dollars, but a lot of money. Now,
yeah, jerk, I told you not to come in here.
Jerk took a lead ball right in the head.
Okay, that's a 15. Let's get out of here, guys. What about Sagan?
Forget him. Let's go. 15.
And dealing with your final thesis that the free market economy is hopelessly mired in atavistic theory, I can only reply by quoting G.K. Chesterton, who once said, "The truest gauge of a healthy economic system..."
All right, Bill.
"...is the freedom..."
Bill, that's enough. I believe you've made your point.
Let me finish, please. "...with which the entrepreneur supplies the demand of his fellow monetarists. Now, would you not agree?"
Yes, yes. You're right, Bill. You've been right about everything all day. Gosh, it's all so clear now.
I'd just like to know where I went wrong with all this left-wing lunacy. It's your fault. You're the one who talked me into it.
You do. I'm sorry. Mr. Buckley is totally correct when he says our real economic strength is in the private sector. So much for that Schlemiel philosophy of mine. Bill, can you ever forgive me?
Well, that's it. I want to join this new and exciting conservative movement, and I hope you'll follow me, Tom.
Sure.
Well, I'm sorry, but we're completely out of time. My apologies to Mr. Jeff Greenfield, who is our mediator. We didn't have a chance to get to any questions from him. Be sure to join me next week when my guest will be Malachi Martin. Till then, good night.
Stint. Stay tuned to SCTV as we continue our coverage of the Battle of the PBS Stars. And now, back to the Battle of the PBS Stars.
Isaac Bashevis Singer once wrote that no sport symbolizes the American spirit, intelligence, mastery, hard-hitting.
Hard-hitting and speed. So let's go now to the introduction of the two football teams. Team number one, led by William F. Buckley, economist Milton Friedman, and author James Baldwin. Wait a minute. I've seen pictures of James Baldwin. He doesn't look like that. That is not James Baldwin. And I'm going over to find out what's going on.
Now, if anybody asks you, you've written Another Country, Giovanni's Room, and Fire Next Time.
Bill Buckley. Excuse me, Milton. Bill, level with me now. Are you trying to tell our viewing audience that that man there is indeed James Baldwin, noted author and essayist?
He most certainly is, ex officio.
You, sir, what is your name?
Baldwin, James Baldwin.
You know, you look more like a football player than you do a writer. A ringer that Bill Buckley has brought in to ensure victory.
Look, little man, I'm James Baldwin, and I wrote
Another Country.
Another Country. You hear what I'm saying?
I certainly do, Mr. Baldwin. Mr. James Baldwin, ladies and gentlemen. Sagan will quarterback his team, and I have to believe that he'll be throwing to his primary receiver, John Kenneth Galbraith, who with his great height advantage is not unlike Harold Carmichael of the Philadelphia Eagles. And his other receiver, Jeff Greenfield, a man of many talents, writer, television critic. Let's take a close look at him now on firing line. They're almost set to go. And the man Bill Buckley has appointed to rush the passer is none other than James Baldwin. Look at Baldwin. He's taking off on Carl Sagan. Scramble, Carl, scramble. Oh, there goes Sagan. He's up in the cosmos where he always wanted to be. But wait, they disqualified Bill Buckley. Ladies and gentlemen, you saw it. This whole thing has turned into a fiasco, a travesty. There may be honor among thieves, but certainly none among intellectuals. And finally, a postscript from my colleague Dick Cavett. I hope you've learned a valuable lesson. That your clever witticisms and sententious rhetoric may arguably have a place on the PBS format, but do not have a place in the sports arena. Frankly, I think this whole event should have been covered by ABC. That's right, ABC, the leader.
Executive producer of SCTV Sports, Rune Caballero Jr. This has been a presentation of SCTV Sports.